My name is Simping, and I'm a junior at Hendricks College. And this past summer, I'm an intern for the Multicultural Student Service. And thank you for being here for our first IMA Movement event. And Multicultural Student Service has started this lecture and workshop series this year. During the course of the year, we are bringing notable speakers and trainers who have dedicated their life to social justice issue. So today we have Mr. Krishna Hari Pushkar, Joint Secretary of the Government of Nepal and the Fulbright Humphrey Fellow at Michigan State University, talking about kafala system and FIFA World Cup. And then everyone get off your calendar and then mark all these events. Okay, so our next event gonna be on Wednesday, 12 to 1 p.m. at Base Dining Hall. We have Harrison Community Task Force on Race Relation will be here to share their work in easing racial tension in the city of Harrison over the last decades. And next Monday, Jane Elliott will be on campus at A Staple Auditorium, so please attend those events as well. And this moment, we would like to invite Vice President of Student Affairs and Dean of the Student, Jim Welchen, to come to the stage and help us unveil the wall of acceptance. And please join me to welcome him with a big round of applause.
Very good. Well, we're very excited and we're very honored to have our guest here today. And for our students who have been coordinating this, we're very thankful as well. Last year, we started a tradition at Hendricks where we introduced the wall of acceptance. And it's something we adopted from the wall of tolerance, where you'll find at the Civil Rights Memorial in Montgomery, Alabama. And students who went on the civil rights trip came back and says, we need to do something that engages our community and talks about how important that is. And as we talked with the students this summer, they said it's not just enough to be accepting. We need something more. And so with that, we want to unveil this year's design, which design, the Honorable Desh Deepak had a very big say in this. This year's theme is I am the movement. And it celebrates youth's involvement with activism. And so what we're asking people to do similar this year is to make a commitment. If you're interested in making that commitment, you would sign the wall, and then we would give you a little sheet of paper that describes what you're committing to. And what you're committing to is at least one act this year that promotes social justice. And that can be on your own terms, but you're going to make that commitment. It's honoring Dr. King's legacy and saying that we're going to make some sort of difference in the world. And so this is a design, and I don't know if Desh had a couple minutes. You want to talk really briefly about why the design is here? And
So as Jim said, the basic concept for this design was to help and let people know that you have to do something to make a change, because whether you like it or not, the world is changing. So the basic inspiration was the time is now, and you have to do something that you care for, the things that you care about.
So after our speaker is done, you'll be the first group to have an opportunity to sign the wall, and then we'll have it available in the SLTC over this week. We're very excited. This is the first year we've had DAO Week, or Diversity Awareness and Openness Week, is this week instead of in April. It made sense to move it to the fall because we can actually learn from it and actually apply it rather than learn from it and leave for the summer. So we moved that around. So we're very fortunate to have that, and we're excited to have the second year. We encourage you to encourage your friends and all members of our community to come and sign this when they're able, and we'll have it available for signing this week. So thank you very much. And now I'd like to introduce our president, William Tsutsui, to come give a few remarks.
Well, thank you so much. I'm really pleased to be here this afternoon. I'm pleased to have such a distinguished guest with us to launch this series. And I really want to thank Desh and all the folks who work with Multicultural Student Services for the work they've put in to making this possible. It is really wonderful we have this opportunity to engage with these issues on the campus. I really could not be happier that we are exploring social justice as a theme this year at Hendricks. The time is right for it. And I also believe that there couldn't be anything better then not just talking about it, but also committing to it. And so I'm so thrilled that the Wall of Acceptance asks us not just to be aware, but to actually make a difference, to do something positive in that regard. And I hope everyone will join me in signing that. It's important that these events are taking place this year in particular, in a year when all of us here in Hendrix are working collectively on a strategic vision for the college, on a plan for the next 5 years going forward, and our priorities, when we're looking afresh at our mission statement and those values that we place above all others in our community, and when we're also examining our identity in how we present ourselves as a community to the larger world. In all of these matters, the issues that this series is addressing are going to be important to us. Diversity is a central issue in the strategic planning process. It is something that I know there's a strong commitment to on this campus, but as with the Wall of Acceptance, it's something we need to think about ways to go beyond awareness and commitment to action. And so I'm going to be challenging the community to think about diversity and climate very broadly over the coming years. I also hope that the themes of social justice and human rights are ones that we can think more deeply about and integrate into our plans for the future, both within the curriculum and beyond. So there is much to do, but it's a great time to do it, and I think this talk today and the series beyond offers us a great jumping-off point for some of those important conversations and significant plan-making that lie ahead. So thank you so much for having me today. It's an honor to be here. I really want to hear the main talk, though.
I'm not the main talk. I'm Graham Senior, the Student Senate President, and I was just asked to give a few remarks and then introduce our lovely guest. So this is such a great project we've got going on here. The I Am the Movement series is all about not waiting on someone else to make changes in the world, to be responsible as an individual in the community and in society, to make the changes that you want to see in the world, as Gandhi said, and that's what this movement requires. So, it is with great pleasure that I'm introducing the first speaker for the I Am the Movement series. Mr. Krishna Hari Pushkar is a native of Nepal and currently Fulbright Hubert H. Humphrey Fellow for 2014-2015 at Michigan State University. Mr. Pushkar is a joint secretary of the Federal Democratic Government of Nepal. He has worked in several top governmental positions, including the post of Director General, Chief District Officer, and Joint Secretary. He has worked in the Ministry of Labor and Employment, Home Affairs, and Foreign Affairs, among others. He represented his government in several bilateral and multilateral international forums. He has been working for the last 16 years in civil service of Nepal. Mr. Pushkar has special expertise in areas such as international labor migration, trafficking control, conflict management, security, and diplomatic challenges. He has participated in several international professional courses and programs in the areas of migration, security, diplomacy, conflict resolution, and cross-culture management. Academically, he obtained a master's degree in public administration from, and I will probably mispronounce this, Tribhuvan University, as well as a master's degree in peace and conflict studies from Otto von Guericke Universität in Magdeburg, Germany. He was recently interviewed by Bryant Gumbel for the HBO show Real Sports with Bryant Gumbel and ESPN. So please give a warm welcome to Mr. Krishna Hari Pushkar.
Thank you so much. Can you hear me all? No? Hello? No. Today, I feel very honored to be here. And first of all, I would like to express my sincere thankful to all Hendrix team, president, and intercultural society, student society, professors, students, and all officials and fellows. It's really great pleasure for me, and I am really excited for this. I was really excited for this event because I am going to talk about the game of glory and game of death. It's two very serious issues because one hand you are talking about the glory that you are going to achieve something that's a very big, and another hand, it's the end of life. That means it's two very serious issues, and today our case will be about Qatar, who is the proposed host for 2022 for the World Cup, one of the biggest game in the world, one of the biggest glorious game in the world, not only in the game, but also in economical terminology, social terminology, and it has lots of associated things. So this will be my topic that I want to share all of you, and it is one of the big government's goal of Nepal that we want to really share about our situation, how we work abroad, how our people work abroad, what the situation about the human rights and all sorts of things. So I think it's one of the crucial topic about the social justice and very relevant for this today that we are going to make commitment here. Today, I'm talking about the kafala. It might be a very new terminology for some of you, and some of you very well known about the situation. Actually, kafala is a system, especially in the Gulf destination, that allow employers to ask them work their migrant worker as a goods or services or as a nothing about the human being, because human being needs some time, some facilities, some basic need, but it doesn't help. If you say you are under kafala system, that you are just not a human being. So I'm going to talk about the kafala system. And most of you know what is FIFA World Cup. Actually, World Cup is the biggest single event. And there are lots of construction before World Cup. You are hosting a World Cup means you are doing lots of things. Lots of infrastructures, stadiums, road, lots of other channels, other things, systems, country need to install before to host a big program, because millions of transactions, millions of movements. If there is World Cup, that means millions of movement, millions of people. And world, single world became one, becomes one village to concentrate their focus. So we are, and Qatar is a sovereign Arab country, and it is one of the richest country in the world. Their per capita income is more than $100,000 per head. So it is one of the biggest in terms of economical monetary incomes. Their people are very rich, they are very luxurious. But at the dark side, we need to know who make them the richest. Who are their really hidden development partners? So today, we are going to focus about the development partners who make them Qatar to be in the richest position of the world. Because we are the people, people from the different developing worlds, they work for them. And now population of Qatar is really less than the migrant worker. Even though migrant workers are so suppressed, you can't imagine. So it's, I'm very serious. Whenever I talk about the series, I feel really big pain in my heart. I feel cry, because every day, while I was working as a director general for my country, every day at 10 o'clock, I had two and three buddies in my airport. And I have to get them clearance. The people are like 30, 25. They have small children. Just for $150, they have to lose their life. So you can imagine how much pain we have been suffering with that. If you look at the population-wise, there are lots of, Qatar population is estimated only 2 million plus. But the migrants population, you can see that. All migrants, especially Indians, Nepalese, Qataris, and we believe that Nepali population is more than half million. It's a legal way. But we don't know about illegal, because there are different dilemma. People go through the legal channels, but once they enter in Qatar, there are some sort of employer, some employer that make them illegal, and they have to lose their life. Someone just run away from somewhere, and they become illegal out of status, and we don't know about the population, and neither they come home back again, nor they come into contact. So how we can know how many population are there? That's the major problem with the kafala system. It's a sponsorship system. You pay something, you will get something, you use as well, as much you want, whenever you want. Because Qatar, kafala system is not related to the labor law. Labor law of Qatar doesn't include kafala system as a employment term. So it's a kind of sponsorship system. if we see that there is a small video, what we do for Qatar. So you can look at that. We make them, we build them a stadium for them. We build them road. We provide them basic needs and services every day. Every piece of the work, there are done by migrant workers. And mostly our migrants are involved in 4D work. We say dry work. If there is high temperature, no one goes to work except migrants. If there is dirty work, only our migrants has to go and work there. Difficult job, dangerous job. If there is question of life or death, then migrants work. So we say that all the migrants under kafala system, they have to work under 4D. Because mostly they are illiterate people. They are not conscious about rights and duties. Even though they are conscious, they have no way to do anything. Because once they are sponsored, everything responsibility goes to the employer. And these are the some infrastructure we are building for them. So let me explain a little bit about case of Nepal. Every day, almost every day, we have 1 to 2 death body to receive in the airports. Every day. Those people who have only legal status, but we don't know about the illegal people. Those people who doesn't have in our paper, those people who doesn't have in our notice. So we are only talking about the legal, but a special position of Nepal is we are very much connected to India. And due to the open border to the India, don't know how much people going there, how much they are coming. Even though besides several diplomatic efforts, we are not able to control our people. And let me share about the story of women. That we say domestic workers. They work inside the bar, once work inside the home, work inside the door. So every day, I had just recently interviewed around 300 women, and most of them said at least 3 or 4 times they have to be raped forcibly. They have to suffer with the unwanted pregnancy, and the employer easily sells or hand over to their friends, guests, wherever they want. Employer, in many cases, they said, okay, you get your salary next month, next month, next month. But they never get salary, they get death at the end. No transactions, no calculation about their salary, about their facility. One hand, we are talking about the human rights, lots of institutions, lots of international documentation, lots of convention. But I don't know why even international community is not being to intervene in this situation. That's one of the most painful things. It's happening in the world. It's slavery. World say, powerful presidents, ministers, prime minister, everyone they claim, right activists they claim, oh, we have abolished the slavery system. There is no more slavery system in the world. But what is this? No rights, no time, no work hour, no standard payment, no grievances handling. Work up to 18 hours per day, even sometimes more. So especially women are really being victimized by this kafala system. Before it was only for the domestic worker, but later they changed and they also converted their construction workers under the kafala system, under the sponsorship system. So if you look at the people, every day they go to sleep, they never wake up. Sometimes they work, they get accident. Instead of making treatment, they just leave them alone for a while and they get dead. And at the last, we receive a kind of medical postmortem report, and they say natural death, nothing, no explanation. No explanation, no detailed postmortem report, no compensation, no insurance. Many people of the world, many prime ministers, we have talked in the United Nations General Assembly. We have put this proposal, discussed this issue in the ILO General Assembly in Geneva. We have talked with the general people, general human rights activists, several ways, but it never works till now. But fortunately, since last year, government of Nepal, with the help of many international organizations, media, especially the Guardian News from the UK, and they help us to do a kind of a special campaign. And now all people of the world, they are supporting the issue. We are a very friendly country. Qatar is a very good neighbor to us. We earn lots of money from the Qatar, but also we have to face lots of deaths. We have really good relation with Qatar, but besides our several efforts, besides our several negotiation, bilateral and multilateral talk, it never gets improved. Although since 2019, we spread this movement, and now everyone is like convinced, and even government of Qatar said that, okay, let's go, we will try to reform this kafala system. However, Qatar government is not able to do some internal constraints, regional constraints, and some other sort of thing. So lots of people every day, lots of disability, lots of murders, lots of diseases. They go like 18 years girls, 20 years girls, they go to Qatar. They come with a baby, no one knows. And once they come with a baby in my country, we have little bit traditional system. They are never get accepted in the family. So only two ways, either go to suicide or displaced from your home. So these are the situation we are suffering in our home. And nowadays we have lots of stakeholders to reform the situation. We are working with Qatar governments. We are working with several other governments and trying to start first the movement, because formal channel didn't work in Qatar. We failed to reform the situation. So now media, especially the media, trade union organizations, human rights activists, students, academicians, they started the movement, and now everyone, we have a kind of bargaining now. We asked government of Qatar, we requested government of Qatar, either please reform this kafala system, or you don't have right to organize this world glorious event like World Cup. Because World Cup is about human rights, about justice, about many well-being, many things. So one hand, one cannot abuse the human rights, and another hand, they say they welcome everything, and world is not going to support. So it's a kind of negotiation point. And finally, government of Qatar really agree, they are really willing to try to do something. But still, no much changes. Even though there are little changes in the law, but no much changes. So we have requested officially all this government authority, FIFA. Last time, just last week in Germany, one of the FIFA executive board members, they say, Qatar cannot host World Cup due to temperature issue, due to human rights issue, and some other issue as well. So there are lots of a kind of negotiation going with Qatar, and Qatar is really now forced to change something. And we request all of you, please do something for the human rights. Please do something for the justice, and talk about this issue at least, write about the issues, and think about your life, who are just 25 years old, who are just 30 years old, who has two children, one children, and go for Qatar to work to get a little bit money, just to feed their hand, just to serve their hand to mouth, to provide basic need and services to their family. They get dead, simply. A reason is natural death. Let me tell you one thing. Anyone, before to go foreign employment, they have to have a strong, pass through the strong medical checkup. They cannot go abroad. Nepal government check very, we have very strict process to check their health systems. We do x-ray, blood test, urine test, whatever possible in our country. And once they qualify medically, then they go to Qatar. And then Qatar government also qualify them, all they go through again all checkups. But after 2 months they're dead, and say natural death. Can you believe that? Isn't it a murder? If you ask people to work in 60 degrees Celsius without heat, if you ask people to work 18 hours every day, if you ask people to carry big iron spade or something, or big equipment, You are going to die in a few days, of course. Lots of issues, lots of treatments. So we said, while I was director general a few months ago, I told them, we should treat this kind of death as a murder. And government of Qatar employer has to justify why it happened. And now we are really in big discussion about the situation. So the movement is now throughout the world. We are working with all world power, all governments, academia, students, journalists, and situation is better little bit. And just recently, government of Qatar has constituted a high-level reform commission from the UK-based law company. It's called D.L. Piper. And they gave a really huge report. On the basis of the report, government of Qatar just a few months ago declared that they are going to reform this labor system, contract system, sponsorship system, and that will apply to all migrant workers who also work under the kafala system. But it's very hard for government or people or migrants to trust on that. I would not say it's government of Qatar is solely responsible. I would also say because there is disconnection. There is a limited interaction between government of Qatar and government and employer. They are the employer. They are the private agencies. They are the mafias. They are the traffickers, employers. They sell people in $200. They use them for 2 months, 3 months. They just sell them for few dollars to others. And unfortunately, we have very limited diplomatic access. Our diplomatic mission is too small. We won't be able to control, monitor, regulate our people who work in Qatar. Because kafala system, those people who work under kafala system, they are under the someone's house or someone in limited space where even government of Qatar cannot access without their permissions. So you don't know what's going to happen inside the room. But still, the commissions going to happen, and Qatar government is really ready, but we don't trust on speech service. Every day, I'm in touch with our laborers. It is not only the issue of Qatar, it is the issue of whole Gulf. But even though government of Qatar want to change something, there are lots of constraints, lots of. I would say, someone says it's part of our religion or social cultural practices. No one has the right to intervene in our domestic issues. The another issue is regional. I would say Saudi Arabia has a big problem. And there was some bitter diplomatic relations just recently between Saudi Arabia and Qatar, and Saudi has pulled their ambassadors due to some issues like that. So even though Qatar want to change something, it's not simple for them. It's really complex issue, complicated issues. But it will change. It will take time. We believe that. So lots of domestic, commercial, because no government, like they have lots of trade issues, oil business, and lots of other business. So no government want to make any bad relation in the name of human rights. Because human rights is kind of, I don't know, when there is direct benefit or direct interest issues, then human rights become secondary issue for discussion or something else. So there are these issues. Gulf Cooperation Council is a big brother syndrome. So Saudi Arabia, without consent of Saudi Arabia, nothing is going to change in really significant level. Then we have elite governance system there that is also hindrance, because it's a kind of kings, lots of high profile people, they use kafala system, but they have lots of influence on the government. So government is not able to do all sorts of things. And then double face of stakeholder. I won't take the name of any president of any country, but when we go and talk about kafala system, we should immediately abolish it. We should impose section. I'm going to bring this proposal to my cabinet or my parliament. But another hand, when they talk to the kafala employer or their respective state, head of the state, oh, you are fine, you are doing good. So majorities of government have the double face while they are dealing with the social justice and human rights. And these are some really big hindrances, obstacles that are not making possible to get significant changes in this system. And we have some recommendations. Government of Nepal has agreed with several multilateral organizations. Qatar government should really reform the law as they have received in the DL Piper report. We say, and it should be visible towards human rights, social justice. People are getting justice. People are treated as a people. We don't ask for any facilities. We just ask only one demand. People should be treated as people. Humans should be treated as human. Nothing else. We are not asking for many things. So we have some recommendations. We try to have some kind of memorandum of understanding in between sending country and receiving country. We try to have some special types of skill to our people that they can protect themselves. They can learn something how to protect themselves. But the involvement of mafias, involvement of human traffickers in the labor migration, it has really made very hard for us. That's a big hurdle for us to enforce all these recommendations. So we really appeal to all of you, please do whatever you can do from your label at least. So people should know, people should contribute something in favor of human rights and social justice. And in conclusion, I would say Qatar is currently working intensively to build all the infrastructures. And we are the development partners. We are not the beggars. We are not the slab. Because we work for them. Instead of work, we get money. And it's called development partner in contemporary terminology. So we ask all these destination countries, including Qatar, please accept us as a development partner instead as a slab supplier country. So this is the issue, and hopefully Qatar will going to accept it. And before to host World Cup, Qatar is really going to change all sort of situation, and we will be in good situation. Before to conclude, I have one German version of video with English footage. It's just a few seconds, and then we start interaction session.
Dem Feind gelungen, die Front in breiter Formation zu durchbrechen. Im Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Marsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steiners wird das alles in Ordnung kommen.
Mein Führer,
Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Es bleiben im Raum Keitel, Jodl, Krebs und Burgdorf. Das war ein Befehl! Der Angriff Steiners war ein Befehl! Wer schickt Sie?
Das hier ist Magen! Sie mein Befehl zu ersetzen! Wie weit ist das einfach gekommen? Der
Militär
hat mich verlogen!
Jeder hat mich verlogen, sogar die SS! Die gesamte Generalität ist nichts weiter als ein Haufen niederträchtiger, treuloser Feiglinge!
Mein Führer, ich kann nicht zulassen, dass die Soldaten, die für Sie verbringen...
Ist das Feiglinge! Verräter, Versager!
Mein Führer, was Sie da sagen, ist ungeheuerlich!
Die Generalität ist das Geschmeiß des deutschen Volkes! Sie ist ohne Ehre! Sie nennen sich Generale, weil Sie Jahre auf Militärakademien zugebracht haben, nur um zu lernen, wie man Messer und Gabel hält.
Jahrelang hat das Militär meine Aktionen nur behindert.
Es hat mit jenen nur gegen Widerstand in den Weg gelegt. Ich hätte gut daran getan, um darin alle höheren Offiziere registrieren zu lassen, wie Stalin. Ich war nie von der Akademie. Und doch habe ich allein auf mich gestellt, ganz Europa erobert. Verräter! Von allem Anfang an bin ich so verraten und betrogen worden. Es wurde ein ungeheurer Verrat geübt am deutschen Volke. Aber alle diese Verräter werden bezahlen. Mit ihrem eigenen Blut werden sie bezahlen. Sie werden saufen in ihrem eigenen Blut.
Bitte, Gerda, jetzt beruhig dich doch.
Meine Befehle sind in den Wind gesprochen. Es ist unmöglich, unter diesen Umständen zu führen. Es ist aus. Der Krieg ist verloren. Aber wenn Sie, meine Herren, glauben, dass ich deswegen Berlin verlasse, irren Sie sich gewaltig. Eher jage ich mir eine Kugel durch den Kopf. Tun Sie, was Sie wollen. Diesen Umständen zu führen. Es ist aus. Der Krieg ist verloren. Aber wenn Sie, meine Herren, glauben, dass ich deswegen Berlin verlasse, irren Sie sich gewaltig. Eher jage ich mir eine Kugel durch den Kopf. Tun Sie, was Sie wollen.
Thank you so much. And now I will be very happy to welcome your questions, queries, and any discussion. I tried my best to explain the situation of human rights, social justice, labor migrations, and situation, slavery, that's going to happen in our world. It's our world. So let's do something for these people, for these victims, and contribute as much possible from your side. Thank you so much, and please, questions and queries.
I was just curious about how young some of the migrant workers can be and if their age plays a role in their treatment.
I couldn't get, could you repeat?
Yeah, how young are some of the migrant workers and does their age affect how they're treated?
Okay, normally our migrant workers can be those who are eligible to have passport. So most of the migrant workers, they go abroad. The below limitation is 18. And then upper can be 40 normally. It's normal. But sometimes 50, 55, they also go. But treatments, you mean the treatments, yeah? The treatments, it depends on the situation, how they go, where they go. Because we have formal channel, informal channel. Very limited people go through the formal channel. But most of them, they go through the illegal channels. That became beyond our control. And it's the trafficker, it's the human smugglers, who immediately starts exploiting since the beginning. Even though we try to stop it, don't want to send, but there are international human rights law that doesn't allow us to make them stop. freedom of movement is their right, so they go wherever they want. And migration is a kind of natural phenomenon. It's about the heart and mind. So if your mood and heart make up mind, you just go wherever you want. So this is the situation. Thank you.
Is it, do the Nepalese and the Indians, and do they always migrate by choice, or is there also an issue of human trafficking that's possibly going on since Qatar is trying to, as you said, the population is pretty small, and they are trying to build all these things by 2022. So I would assume that maybe some human traffickers are trying to get people to come and be forced labor. So is it always by choice that the Nepalese leave the country, or are some of them being?
Very, thank you, very crucial question. Because both. Just 2 years ago, there was one report, Amnesty International reports, and it's called false promises. So there are lots of false promises involved. They go, the human trafficker go to the schools, they go to the village, and they say, you are doing nothing here. Let's go to work, you will get $500 per month. Very fancy job, you have all the sorts of things, you don't have to invest any penny even. We fund you for your passports, air tickets. So there are lots of false promises distribution being distributed throughout the Nepal. And of course, the other sections, they go by the choice, because we have the manpower company, which are recruitment companies. They advertise their demand about the Gulf, especially Qatar and other countries as well. And people apply for that. So someday, we say 50-50 situation is like. But we don't have much information about illegal activities. Although we are trying to take actions as much as possible against the human trafficker. But due to the geopolitical situation of Nepal, due to the airport, frequent air, we have only one international airport in Kathmandu that we can trace and control many people as we can whenever we want. But in India, there are so many international airports. You don't need even passport or anything. Just walk around and fly wherever you want. This makes a little bit trouble. And there are some technological development, e-visa system. In the airport, they say, I'm going to India. In the airport, they just show citizenship or passport. But when they go to India, they move forward. Because they have e-ticket, they make different bookings, and you don't know where they are going. So twice and force as well, both.
Thank you. Are there some issues of unequal pay? For example, if somebody gets to Qatar, does some of his pay or maybe wage goes to the person who maybe smuggled him into the country? Or it's otherwise, they get paid cash or whatever?
I would say it's we can take example of the United States. I saw in California, I work with the Labor Agriculture Relations Board in California, and I had opportunity to interact with the several undocumented labor, they say in the United States. When they work, they get $6, $7 per hour in cash, because they don't have right to go and complain somewhere officially, because even though Labor Relations Board, they doesn't ask for the immigration status, people fear. Oh, Homeland Security or Immigration Citizenship Service will come and they will deport me or something. So obviously, similarly in Nepal, in Qatar, Nepalese gets low paid if they are undocumented or if they are going through indirect channels, illegal channels. But those who go through the legal channels, they get properly paid, but general payment rate is less than $200. Less than $200. So discrimination. And there are also conflict among the wages of the sending countries. Like Filipino peoples go and do the same work, they get higher pay. Like people from the Bangladesh, they even get less pay than Nepalese. People from the India, so there are lots of disparities because labor law doesn't apply for this kafala system, especially. And if you are legal, there are some special points. The employer make you forcibly illegal. that neither you can go to the police or immigration or your embassy. If you go to your police, they will employer call to the police, they say, she or he has steal so many ornaments, money from my home, and then police put you in prison. Even for the dead body, you need exit visa. So don't think you are going without any consent of your employer. Even for the dead body. And sometimes to get our dead body, it takes up to 2 years. And we are talking about human rights, social justice, and this sort of thing. So this is the situation. Another question?
Is there anything that FIFA can do to bring pressure on the government of Qatar, or is that something that's being pursued by the Nepalese government?
Thank you. Government of Nepal very frequently approach, almost every week. We meet, we talk with the head of the state, head of the government, their embassies abroad. We talk in the UN systems. We talk in so many bilateral, multilateral forums. They are very positive. Qatari people are very nice, actually, in talking, in behaving other than this issue. They are really great people. But when the issue comes about real, something to do into the practice, no way. So these days, especially the media, civil society, right activists, academicians, because government afraid about their trade, government afraid about their commerce activities. But media, they are really acting nicely, they are talking, and now Qatar government is pressurized, and they are really trying to do something, even in a small scale, although they are not able to do, as per our research conclusion, due to some regional, domestic factors, cultural issues. But we need to keep them, continue the pressures, and hopefully in future, before they host World Cup, we'll be able to succeed in our mission. At least, we don't ask for anything. Just simply say, humans should be treated as human. You accept migrant worker as a man, that's it, nothing except that. Any question?
It's hard to listen to this talk and not think about Brazil and all of the incredible human rights abuses, land displacement, obviously labor issues as well that we saw on kind of a global scale, and yet the World Cup went on and it was very successful, and FIFA had this big role in I think being complicit in a lot of these human rights abuses that took place in Brazil. So I'm curious if you have a sense of whether or not there's some discussion about, lessons from Brazil, right? How can we learn from what happened this past summer and the fact that it still went on quite successfully, right? For, at least audiences who are watching around the world. So is there some, kind of a study of what happened this past summer and a way to move on from that for
Thank you. Actually, just recently, along with our Honorable Labor Minister, I was a part of the delegation and visited Brazil. And we had really serious talk about all those issues. So we are really trying hard to take necessary precautions from Brazilian experience and to improve our situation to avoid these potential abuses in Qatar. We have asked International Labor Organization to pass a special types of resolutions, because we have so many resolutions. In 2011, we had also one resolution about the right of domestic workers, but it didn't work in the field. So we are asking UN systems some human rights followers or countries, special countries like United States, UK, European Union, to coordinate and collaborate us to avoid these types of potential abuses. And one of our special team preparing a kind of a special homework, and that will certainly help us to avoid this potential problem. But although, until and unless domestic government, the government of Qatar, they accept this thing, they realize these things, we can't make significant change in the other country. But we try to minimize unskilled labor in our home, because most of the abuses, most of the exploitations, extortions happened with our unskilled laborers. So we try to change the system, we try to empower them in our home, and we want them to make aware, empowered, if there is something happen, then how to be protected there, like self-protection or something, how to they can communicate with our diplomatic missions, how can they can communicate with the right wage agency, and they can protect their life. Where there is only issue, life. Because you never know, if someone flies to Gulf, we don't know when, whether they are going to come back or not. This is the issue, and we are trying to learn from the Brazil as well. And we are very much in close coordination with the Brazilian government. And some of the NGOs in Brazil, some of the right-based agencies, we are in touch and working together with them. Thank you.
After like the 2014 World Cup, you saw the problems with the international labor organizations. They are not able to help the people in Brazil get some fair pay. The same thing is happening in Russia. And those like Brazil 2014, Russia 2018, and the same thing again is happening in Qatar. And FIFA is not doing anything. So do you think maybe there's some kind of corruption or something going down FIFA officials as far as they are signing the World Cups to different groups of countries that are constantly violating the World Cup?
Actually, very genuine question. It's a global question related to our international relation and international diplomacy. To fight against this situation, we have one global forum. It's called Global Forum on Migration and Development. And many countries of the world, we sit together and very frequently talk and discuss about the issue. I can't say no the claim you talked about. People are thinking that there are some possibilities, some of the FIFA people are involved on that. But there is no evidences to accuse them for that. Although there are lots of informal investigations going on by the right activists and some trade union, international trade union committees. So even about the Russia, or wherever World Cup is, not only World Cup, but there are lots of migrants workers in Russia from the Central Asia. So there we have some forums where we talk and exchange about these activities, and we are really conscious about the situation, and hopefully similar types of situation is not going to happen. If there is going to happen, we have some international instruments that we need to take actions, we need to impose some necessary legal actions, maybe blacklisting or something. So we have some blacklist as well in our country. If government is not cooperating us, then we don't allow our people to go at all. There are so many countries in our blacklist. We have blacklist for the employer. We have the blacklist for the country as well. At least we can do that, and other sorts of bilateral actions we can also take.
First of all, it's nice to have a Nepali speaker here. I'm also Nepali, and I noticed this and I witnessed this firsthand in the airport. There's like this whole procedure to write everything before you go to the terminal. Mm-hmm. And while I was there, like after I finished and I was about to go, I was pulled. Someone pulled my hand, and they asked me, "Hey, can you fill this out for me? Because I don't know how to read Nepali," and he was Nepali himself. And I helped him because I thought it was like the right thing to do. I did that, and sure enough, like more people came, and almost all of them were like migrant, like they were going to go abroad, like Malaysia, Qatar, mm-hmm. And it just made me realize that most of these people, they're not literate at all, and they're just going somewhere to give sustenance to their family, earn some money, and this is not like are they aware of the dangers? It's not the first time that this Nepali immigrants have been exploited either, because years ago I remember there was this Iraqi situation where Nepalese were beheaded and caused another outcry, and it just seems to me that the manpower company should also have a role in like letting them know of the casualties and dangers.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, very interesting and crucial questions. Yes, as I told you in beginning, they are mostly illiterate, unskilled people, and they are victimized by the false promises. Oh, you are working in the field, you just get $100 or $50 per month. If you go to work there, you will get like $200. And manpower companies, while I was director general, I took action more than 100 manpower companies because they involve in human trafficking. Actually, the mafia governments, we say mafia governance, they are really, they have huge network. They don't have any types of, like we have limitation that we can't have office in another country or that country, but they have so nice network that they can do whatever they want in most of the cases, especially in developing world, because we won't be able to trace them, regulate them so quickly as we should. So lots of manpower companies, lots of employers, they use human trafficker networks. They do illegal things in formal procedure. They use formal procedure though, but they do illegal things. They conduct a kind of advertisement in the media. They take interview, everything, but most of the things they produce fake. So when I was in department, more than 90% of the documents they submitted to department to obtain the work permit to go abroad was fake, we found. And we won't be able to even identify whether it's fake document or original document. So this year, we have introduced potential crime verification systems, and we're trying to trace the situation. And now, the level, degree of crime, human trafficking, is getting a little bit decreased. And lots of our partners, US government, USID, international level organizations, DFID, some other human rights organization and civic society, they are helping us to minimize this problem. And we had also our problem in our own system, lots of corruptions, lots of authority abuses. So we have really, these days we are trying to take really strong actions, and mass level of some civil servants are under custody due to these corruptions. We fired them now. The cases are under court now. So we are trying to strengthen the situation, and hopefully the degree of human trafficking will be decreased. But there are many people who use India, Dubai, Bangkok, Singapore, Hong Kong as a transit country. They just go there for the tourist, in tourist visa. If you have $500, if you have hotel reservation, you have to allow people to go wherever they want. And it's original, they manage for them. And they go, they stay a few days, and then get another visa and to go work somewhere. So these are the situation, and we are trying to, just recently, we don't have machine readable passport. Just last year we introduced machine readable passport system effectively in mass level. We had a kind of manual passport, like my name is Krishna, and your name is Deepak, you can just change the photo on the passport very easily, and you can just go wherever you want. And there is some corrupt officials, even though they knew somehow it's a fake, they take bribe and allow them to go wherever they want. But now we got machine readable passport, and we are trying to improve our immigration situation as well, our regulations. But still, we have open border is a big challenge for us. And some international instruments, freedom of movement, If you say you have passport, you want to go somewhere, you are allowed to go. But we want to stop in some condition our people. But they go court, and court say no, it's their right to go wherever they want. You should not do something. So even sometimes we make some administrative arrangements. So the best option is we should empower our people, but we have very less limited resources. We can't train them properly. We have lots of employment opportunities in agriculture. We are suffering with a huge labor shortage in my country, huge. And there was one informal study that says in remittances and out remittance is little bit almost same. Because we ask people from the India, Bihar and North, Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, it's an Indian state, and our labor takes like 10,000 Nepali rupees before, and now they took they charge us 15,000. We don't have our labor. Our labor goes to work abroad for 15,000, but we have to pay another foreign labor more. So it's a discussion going on. Lots of Chinese, thousands of Chinese. And one of the most surprising things, we had 15,000 foreigners working illegal in Nepal. They work in construction, hydropower, wherever they want before. We have now regulated them. But still, I don't know, there are lots of false promises, lots of, how to say, fashion a kind of, they just want to go. And they use these earnings in unproductive things. They just build house and they come in similar situation. Rest they get dead. Some get huge diseases, hepatitis, HIV or something. Disabled situation. Any more? Thank you so much, and I feel really honored. And I hope you all have able to understand the issues that I try to explain. And expecting some of you are going to do something from your level, wherever, whenever, whatever you want to do, do for the human rights, social justice. And this is our appeal on behalf of government of Nepal, on behalf of me, and on behalf of our people. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Have a good evening to all.